Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Crepe Expectations by Sarah Fox, narrated by Marguerite Gavin. Chapter 1. A banner with bold lettering rippled in the breeze. It gave a snap now and again when a stronger gust tried to wrest it free of the table it was fastened to, but it remained in place, the thick paper refusing to tear. So far the banner had done its job, grabbing people's attention and directing them to the table where I sat with a stack of papers in front of me. "Looks like we've got the makings of a great competition this year," Patricia Murray commented from the chair next to mine. "I had no idea it would be this popular," I admitted, running my eyes down the list of names written on one of the papers. I leaned back in my folding chair and stretched my legs under the table, set up in the parking lot of Wildwood Cove's grocery store. It was early on a Saturday afternoon, and normally at that time of day I'd be at my pancake house, the flip side, closing up and tidying the restaurant. Today, however, I'd agreed to volunteer my time to help with registration for the Olympic Peninsula's annual amateur chef competition. Each year, one of the peninsula's communities hosted the competition, and this time it was Wildwood Cove's turn. The event would take place over the following 3 weekends, and already several residents of Wildwood Cove and other towns had signed up. I'd been sitting at the registration table for 2 hours, and people were still arriving to put their names down for either the teen division or the adult category. I was worried with all the rain this year that most people wouldn't want to come out and participate, Patricia said. She owned a bed and breakfast 3 properties away from my beachfront Victorian, and she was also on the organizing committee for the amateur chef contest. "We're definitely lucky the weather decided to change," I said before Patricia greeted the latest person to approach the registration table. I'd spent many of my summer vacations in Wildwood Cove while growing up in Seattle, but I'd only moved to the seaside town permanently the previous spring and had never been present for the cooking competition. It sounded like fun, though, and I was eager to be involved with the community, so I hadn't hesitated about volunteering to help out when Patricia had asked me. My participation would be limited to assisting with registration, but I'd been assured that I was providing some much-needed help. As Patricia registered a teenage girl with dark hair even curlier than mine, I breathed deeply, enjoying the fresh air and the lack of rain. The peninsula had seen very little sunshine over the past 2 months, and the rainfall had been so heavy and persistent that the nearby river had flooded its banks, damaging some homes and causing a slew of problems. Now that we'd had a few days without any rain, the floodwaters were finally receding, allowing everyone to breathe easier, even though many people had a long road of cleanup and restoration ahead of them. I sat up straighter when I noticed a 50-something woman approaching the registration table. She had her light brown hair tied back in a bun, and she walked with careful steps. A man about her age followed along behind her and hung back when she reached the table. I greeted her and provided her with the registration form. Her name was Dorothy Kerwin, I noted as she filled in the form with her name, address, and the division she was entering. When she'd completed the form, I provided her with the booklet that every entrant received. It contained the rules and the event schedule. "Hi, Dorothy," Patricia said with a smile when she'd finished registering the teenage girl. "How are you doing these days?"
"Better, thank you," Dorothy replied with a hint of a smile.
"Are you ready to go, Dot?"
the man hovering behind her asked as he glanced at his watch. "Sorry," she said to me and Patricia. "I'd better be on my way." Despite the man's impatience, he didn't hurry Dorothy once they set off, one of her arms tucked into his.
"Had you met Dorothy and Willard Kerwin before today?" Patricia asked me once we were alone.
"No. The poor woman has been through a lot over the past year or two. She fell off a stepladder and broke her back, and then her twin sister passed away while Dorothy was still in the hospital."
"That's terrible," I said with a surge of compassion for the woman. "I think this is the first time she's participated in any community event since all that happened, so it's nice to see her getting involved."
I was about to agree with her when I caught sight of my boyfriend, Brett Collins, out of the corner of my eye. I smiled and waved as he approached, carrying 2 takeout cups from the local coffee shop, The Beach and Bean. The light breeze ruffled his blonde hair as he reached the table.
"A coffee for you, Patricia,"
he said, setting one of the cups in front of her.
And a matcha latte for you, Marley.
He handed the second cup to me. We both thanked him. Since no one was waiting to be registered at that moment, I got up to give him a hug and a quick kiss. Did you get something for yourself? I asked.
Yep, a sandwich and a coffee. I put them in the truck.
I'm guessing you have to head back to work now.
I do, but I should be done for the day in about 3 hours.
He was on his lunch break from his landscaping work at an old Victorian mansion that would soon be opening to guests as the Wildwood Inn. Brett ran his own lawn and garden business, and the new owners of the mansion had hired him to landscape and prepare the gardens before the inn's grand opening, which would be marked by a garden party later in the month. The mansion's owners, Lonnie and Hope Barron, had spent the past several months restoring the Victorian and getting it ready for its new life as an inn. I'll see you at home then, I said, leaning into him for another hug before reluctantly releasing him. Hello, everyone, Brett's sister Chloe breezed over to us, her blue eyes bright. She caught sight of the cups Patricia and I held. Drinks from the Beach and Bean? That's where I'm headed.
That makes more sense,
Brett said. More sense than what? Chloe asked.
For a second there, I thought you were here to register for the cooking competition.
Why wouldn't that make sense? Patricia asked as Chloe's smile morphed into a frown. Brett slung an arm across Chloe's shoulders.
Because my kid sister couldn't cook to save her life.
I can so cook, Chloe retorted, giving him a shove. She looked to me for support. You make good cookies, I said. I know that much.
You mean the ones Jordan made for the 4th of July barbecue?
Brett asked, referring to their cousin. Hey, I helped, Chloe protested.
Right. I seem to recall that you spooned the dough onto the cookie sheets and Jordan did the rest.
I'm sure you can cook, I said to Chloe, wanting to placate her before things escalated.
Of course,
Brett said, trying to keep a straight face.
She can make toast, rubbery scrambled eggs, and pasta, as long as the pasta comes from a store and the sauce comes out of a jar.
He addressed his sister.
And what about the time you tried to cook a family dinner and nearly burned down the house?
Chloe's gaze hardened. It was a tiny little fire, and I put it out right away. I couldn't help but laugh, and beside me, Patricia was struggling to contain a smile. You're no help, Marley, Chloe said, turning her frown on me. I'm sorry. I quickly took a sip of my latte to keep myself from laughing again. Chloe grabbed a pen off the table. Registration form, please, she said to me. I glanced at Brad and then back at her before handing over a form.
What are you doing?
Brett asked. Exactly what it looks like. Chloe wrote her name on the form. I'm signing up for the competition.
Hasn't the town seen enough disaster lately with all the flooding?
Chloe pressed the pen so hard against the paper that I was surprised when it didn't tear. Just you wait. I'm going to make you eat your words.
They'll probably taste better than your scrambled eggs.
Chloe threw the pen at him. He caught it right before it smacked him in the face. Chloe passed me the completed form, and I gave her a booklet. You'll see, she said, swatting her brother's arm with the booklet before storming off, heading in the direction of the coffee shop. Brett, I said, you shouldn't tease her like that.
But it's so fun,
he said with a smile. I shook my head, and he wrapped his arms around me.
I've got to run,
he said in my ear.
See you later.
After giving me a quick kiss, he left for his truck, parked on the street. A group of three teenagers arrived to register for the youth division, so Patricia and I kept busy for the next several minutes. Two adults registered after that, but then we had another lull. Patricia's cell phone rang, and she got up from the table, walking a few steps away before answering the call. While she was still occupied, Logan Teeves arrived and asked to register. Logan was 17 and lived next door to me with his dad, Gerald. He'd dated Patricia's daughter, Sienna, for a while, and although they'd broken up, they were still friends. I didn't realize you liked cooking, I said as Logan filled out the registration form. He shrugged and brushed his fair hair off his forehead.
My dad doesn't cook, so we'd always be eating takeout and frozen dinners if I didn't learn.
He shrugged again.
It's kind of fun.
Well, I think it's great that you're entering. I handed him a booklet. Good luck. Logan wandered off, and Patricia returned to the table, dropping into her seat with a worried frown on her face. "What's wrong?" I asked. That was Sid Michaels on the phone. "The owner of Scoop's Ice Cream?" Patricia nodded. He was supposed to be one of the judges for the competition, but now he has to make an unexpected trip to San Francisco. He's not sure when he'll be back, but he thinks he'll be gone at least 2 weeks. "So now you need another judge," I surmised. "As soon as possible." "Would you be able to step in, Marley?" she asked. "I could," I said slowly, "but I don't eat meat." "Right, and that would be a problem, especially for the first challenge." On the opening day of the competition, the contestants would be cooking main course dishes with the dessert challenge the following week. Patricia swiped away a strand of dark hair that the breeze had blown across her face. "How about Ivan? Do you think he'd be willing to step in?" "To be honest, I'm not sure." Ivan Kaminski was the flip side's talented chef. He was a wizard in the kitchen and more than qualified to take on the role as judge for the competition, but he wasn't the most social man, and I wasn't sure how he'd feel about taking part in the event. "I could ask him, though." "Would you?" Patricia said with obvious relief. "That would be fantastic. When do you need a definitive answer?" "As soon as you can get one." I pulled my phone from my pocket. "I'll send him a text now, and if I don't hear back from him today, I'll talk to him about it in the morning." "Thanks, Marley, that's a huge help." I really wasn't sure how Ivan would respond to the request, but I decided to do my best to convince him to help with the judging, even if it did put me in direct line of one of his intimidating scowls. A few minutes later, I received a curt text message in response.
"We'll talk tomorrow."
I didn't share the reply with Patricia, not quite knowing what to make of it. At least he hadn't said no outright. But I wasn't entirely sure what to expect in the morning. Chapter 2. When I left for the flip side the next day, the few clouds overhead were tinged with pink, and the sun was creeping its way up over the eastern horizon. I set off on foot, walking along the beach toward town and enjoying the peace and quiet of the early morning. Other than the gentle lapping of the waves against the shore and the occasional call of a bird, there wasn't a sound to be heard. Breathing in the fresh, salty air, I couldn't help but be in a good mood. I loved walking to work, and over the past few months, I'd driven more often than I'd made the trip on foot. Between the cold, dark weather of winter and the incessant rain in March, I hadn't had many opportunities to enjoy the beauty and tranquility of Wildwood Beach. Once I'd left the sand for the paved promenade that ran along the front of the Pancake House and other beachfront businesses, I fished my keys out of my tote bag and had the right one ready when I reached the flip side. As usual, Ivan and his assistant Tommy had arrived before me, and the light from the kitchen spilled out through the pass-through window into the dim dining area. I flicked on the overhead lights and dropped off my tote bag and jacket in the office before heading for the kitchen. "Good morning," I greeted as I pushed through the swinging door. I received a cheerful hello from Tommy and a nod from Ivan. The chef was in the midst of slicing up a log of dough with cinnamon and sugar swirled inside. Even though the maple pecan sticky rolls weren't cooked yet, my mouth watered at the sight.
"Isn't there someone else who can judge the competition?"
Ivan asked, tearing my attention away from the sliced dough.
"The amateur chef competition?"
Tommy asked. Ivan gave a grunt of confirmation. "Sid Michaels from Scoop's Ice Cream was supposed to be on the judging panel, but he's had to leave town unexpectedly, so Patricia's in a bit of a lurch," I explained. "She'd really appreciate it if you could help out, Ivan." He spared me a brief glance, his dark eyes settling on me only for a second before he returned to his work. A year ago, I would have been intimidated standing there before the muscular, tattooed chef, but I now knew that beneath his burly, imposing exterior was a good heart.
"The competition starts next Saturday afternoon,"
he said as he sliced the last piece of dough in half.
"I'll be working."
"If you leave right after we close, you'll be able to make it in time."
"I'll still have work to do after closing." "I can handle the cleanup and next day's prep," Tommy offered. "I don't mind staying a bit later than usual."
"Thanks, Tommy," I said with a grateful smile. Ivan glared at us before placing the sliced sticky rolls in a baking dish and passing it to Tommy. He wiped down the counter next, all the while leaving me in suspense. Finally, his eyes met mine again.
I'll help with the judging.
I couldn't stop another smile from spreading across my face. Thank you, Ivan. Patricia will be so relieved. I hurried out of the kitchen and fetched my phone from the office so I could text Patricia the good news. With that done, I started my workday, and an hour later the first customers had arrived, hungry for breakfast. This weather is a welcome change, isn't it? Eleanor Crosby said as I delivered a plate of blueberry crumble pancakes to her. That's for sure, I said, sliding a plate of marzipan pancakes in front of her dining companion, Marguerite Wells. Did either of you have any trouble with flooding? Not us, thank goodness, Marguerite replied. But my nephew had a couple of inches of water in his crawl space. Oh, I'm sorry to hear that, I said. So many people have been left with a mess to deal with. Eleanor took a sip of her coffee. At least the river level's going down now. I agreed that was a good turn of events and left the ladies to eat. While the aftermath of the flooding was a hot topic of conversation that morning, many diners were also chatting about the amateur chef competition and the upcoming garden party at the Wildwood Inn.
Rhett's working on the gardens up at the inn, isn't he?
Gary Thornbrook asked. He was having breakfast with his buddy Ed, as he did at least twice every week. Ed and Gary were the Flipside's most frequent customers, and they rarely strayed from their usual selection from the menu. Blueberry pancakes with bacon and sausages on the side. He is, I said as I topped off Gary's coffee. It's a lot of work for him, especially since he's got all his regular clients to deal with as well. He's thinking of hiring someone to help him, at least part-time.
He's done well with his business,
Ed said. He has, I agreed with a rush of pride. Before moving on to the next table with the pot of fresh coffee, I paused and asked, Are you two going to the garden party?
If we can still fit into our suits,
Gary said with a laugh, patting his generous stomach. I smiled and continued on to the neighboring table. The last diners of the day left the restaurant shortly after 2 o'clock, and I locked the door behind them, flipping the open sign to closed. Lee Hunter, the Flipside's full-time waitress, untied her red apron from around her waist. Patricia Murray's daughter, Sienna, did the same with her apron. Sienna was 17 and still in school, but she worked at the Pancake House on the weekends. Did you know that Logan's entering the amateur chef competition? I asked Sienna. Yep. He's a really good cook. He got into watching cooking shows about 3 years ago, and now he can make some really amazing stuff. I hope he does well in the competition, Lee said. He will, Sienna said with confidence. My friend Ellie Shaw's entering, too. She didn't really want to, but her mom thought she should. Why didn't she want to? I asked. She's kind of shy. I don't think she likes the idea of cooking in front of an audience.
Maybe she'll forget anyone's watching once she gets cooking,
Lee said. I hope so. She's really talented, especially with desserts. Sienna headed for the break room to fetch her jacket, and soon she and Lee had left the Pancake House for the day. Talking about cooking made me wonder if Brett would be finished work by dinner time. I sent him a text message asking him how things were going. I tidied up the Pancake House while waiting for his response. It came about half an hour later. He figured he'd have to work until 6 o'clock, but he hoped he wouldn't have to stay at the inn any longer than that. Hungry? I wrote in another text. I can bring you a snack.
I love you,
was his quick response. Smiling, I finished up my remaining tasks and grabbed a can of soda from the kitchen before heading out. I walked to Marielle's bakery and picked up 2 donuts and half a dozen chocolate chip cookies. From there, I set a course for home. The Wildwood Inn sat on the outskirts of town, and making the trip on foot would have taken a while, so I decided to make a quick stop at home to pick up my car. After checking on my cat, Flapjack, and Brett's dog, Bentley, I set off in my hatchback. When I reached my destination, I followed a long driveway toward the beautiful white Victorian mansion and continued along the branch that led around the house to the large detached garage, built in the same style as the inn. I parked my blue hatchback next to the cube van Brett used for his lawn and garden business. With the paper bakery bag and soda can in hand, I wandered around the garage until I could see clear to the back of the inn's property. An expanse of green lawns stretched from the mansion to a white gazebo. A new addition, Brett had told me. Beyond the gazebo, flagstone pathways wandered around numerous flower beds. Brett had been working hard to add some color before the garden party. He'd already transplanted numerous types of flowers in a variety of hues and would add more over the coming days. Some of the flower beds farther back in the garden were home to recently planted rose bushes, which would bloom in a few weeks' time. As soon as I started across the lawn, I spotted Brett near the back of the property, working away at one of the last flower beds, only a stone's throw from the woods that bordered the garden. There was a small cottage in the back corner of the lot, but I couldn't see anyone else around. The garden was peaceful, the only sound the chirping of birds in the trees. I followed the flagstone pathway past the flower beds, raising a hand in greeting when Brett looked up and saw me approaching. "I come bearing food," I said as I reached him. He grinned and drove the spade he was holding into the soil so it would stand upright on its own.
"Best news I've heard all day."
I glanced around the garden. "You've made a lot of progress since the last time I was here. It looks great."
"I need to work at a couple of other sites this week, but hopefully this job will be done in the next 2 weeks."
He pulled off his work gloves and tucked them into the back pocket of his jeans.
"How was your day?"
"Great. Everything went well at the flip side. A lot of people were talking about the garden party. They're going to love what you've done here."
"Hopefully Lonnie and Hope will love it too,"
he said. "They will," I said without any doubt. "They like what you've done so far, right?"
"So far, so good,"
he confirmed. I held up the paper bag and can of soda. "Your snack."
"Thank you. You're the best."
"I can't say I was disappointed to have a chance to see you before tonight." He grinned.
"I'm definitely not disappointed either."
He led me to a stone bench at the end of the garden that faced the flower beds, the mansion visible in the distance. I sat with him and snacked on one of the donuts while he devoured the other one along with a couple of cookies. When I'd finished eating, I rested my head against his shoulder. "It's so peaceful here," I said, listening to the bird song coming from the woods behind us. Brett took a long drink of his soda.
"It's definitely a nice place to work."
I raised my head. "Speaking of which, I should probably let you get back to it." He eyed the rose bushes sitting in pots near one of the flower beds, waiting to be transplanted.
"Another 2 hours or so, and then I'll be heading home."
I got to my feet and set the paper bag on the bench. "I'll leave these here in case you want more." Brett set down his soda can as he stood up. He took my hands, pulling me in close.
"Thanks for stopping by, Marley."
He gave me a lingering kiss that I reluctantly pulled away from.
"See you later."
I was about to set off along the garden path when something small and black streaked toward the tree line. I spun around to follow its progress. "A kitten," I exclaimed. "Did you see that?" A tiny black cat paused at the edge of the woods, its green eyes wide, one ear twitching while the rest of its body remained frozen. "Does it belong to Lonnie and Hope?" I asked.
"I don't know," Brett said. "I caught a brief glimpse of it earlier today, but that's the first time I've seen a cat around here."
I took a careful step toward the kitten. It dashed beneath a bushy fern and hunkered down, out of sight except for the tip of one black ear. "It looks way too tiny to be out here on its own," I said.
"We can take it up to the house and see if that's where it belongs. If we can catch it, that is."
As if it heard Brett's words, the little kitten darted out from its hiding place and zipped away, deeper into the woods. "Catching it might not be possible, but I don't want to leave it in the woods. Maybe we can at least get it to run back this way?"
"We can try,"
Brett agreed. We moved off in opposite directions, planning to circle around into the woods and hopefully herd the kitten back to the garden. I tried to move quietly as I entered the woods, not wanting to scare the cat farther into the forest. Despite my efforts, twigs still snapped under my feet, and the underbrush rustled as I picked my way through the trees. I could hear rushing water somewhere nearby and realized we were close to the Wildwood River. My concern for the kitten shot up. Although the water level was on its way down, the river was still higher than usual and could be dangerous for anyone who got close to the slippery, unstable banks. I didn't want the kitten going anywhere near the water. As I moved deeper into the forest, the dirt beneath my feet became soggier. Through the trees, I caught sight of the river, still swollen and muddy, hurtling its way toward the ocean. I swept my gaze from left to right, desperately seeking out any sign of the kitten. "Can you see it?" I called out to Brett when he came into view. We were almost to the river now, and I had to talk over the sound of the rushing water.
"Not yet,"
Brett called back. At the sound of his voice, something moved slightly a few feet away. I peered at a small, hollowed-out cavity at the base of an old tree. It was dark inside the hole, but I was certain I'd seen movement. I crept closer to the tree, moving slowly and cautiously. I was about to crouch down in front of the hole when the kitten darted out of the hollow tree. I dropped my knees and grabbed at the kitten, ending up flat on my stomach, my arms outstretched ahead of me. A fallen tree branch poked at my ribs. Cold moisture was seeping through my jeans, and I had a face full of ferns. But I also had a wriggling kitten in my grasp.
"Are you okay?"
Brett asked as he hurried over to me. "I caught it," I said through the ferns. I couldn't see too well, but I heard Brett reach my side. One of his hands brushed against mine.
"I've got it. You can let go now."
I released my firm but gentle hold on the cat and climbed to my feet, brushing pine needles and clumps of mud from my clothes. I smiled at the sight of Brett holding the little kitten against his chest. But when I reached down to brush a clod of mud from my knee, my smile slipped away. "Brett?
Are you hurt?"
he asked with concern. I shook my head and stepped back before pointing at the ground. Next to the patch of ferns I'd landed in, a partial human skull poked out through the mud. Chapter 3. I couldn't tear my gaze away from the skull, even though the sight of it set an uncomfortable chill creeping up my spine. The empty eye sockets gaped at me, and everything around me suddenly seemed more sinister. The shadows, the rustling of leaves, the roar of the nearby river. I shivered.
"Are you okay?"
Brett asked. I nodded. The kitten let out a squeak of a meow. Finally, I managed to look away from my unsettling discovery. The little cat was a welcome distraction. He'd struggled at first, but was now settled against Brett's chest. I didn't know why I'd started to think of the cat as male, but I figured I had a 50% chance of being right. I marked the location of our find with one of Brett's work gloves, gliding it over the end of a spindly tree branch. We gave the partially exposed skull a wide berth, even though we'd already trampled over the surrounding area. When we emerged from the woods, Brett handed me the kitten and pulled his phone from the pocket of his jeans.
"I'll call Ray,"
he said, waking up the device. Ray Georgeson was the sheriff of Clallam County and Brett's uncle. I held the little kitten close to me, and he settled in my arms with a purr. He seemed too comfortable with me to be feral, so I thought there was a good chance he belonged to the mansion. "I'll take you up to the house soon," I told the kitten as I half-listened to Brett's side of the conversation with his uncle. He was only on the phone for a minute before he hung up.
"Ray's on his way, but he's in Port Angeles, so he'll be a while. Deputy Mendoza might be able to get here sooner, though."
Brett tucked his phone back in his pocket and picked up the bag of cookies.
"He wants us to wait up at the house."
"We can ask where this guy belongs while we're there," I said, running my hand over the kitten's black fur, his purr growing louder in response. As we walked along the flagstone path, I tried unsuccessfully to stop a shiver from working its way up my spine. "I guess that skull's been there a while."
"It must have been,"
Brett agreed,
"and it might have stayed there a lot longer if not for the flood."
I knew what he meant. The skull was located within the area that had flooded recently, and had likely been exposed as a result of the river water flowing over it and carrying away the top layer of dirt. "Do you think there's a chance that whoever it is died accidentally?" I asked, trying to hold on to that hope, even though it already seemed like a faint one.
"I guess a homeless person could have been camped out in the woods and died there without anyone knowing,"
Brett said.
"But then
the skeleton wouldn't have been buried," I finished for him.
Although, maybe it was the passage of time, or an animal that buried it. We don't know for sure that there's a full skeleton. It could just be the skull.
And it could be from some ancient burial ground.
Could be.
We fell silent, all the possibilities running around and around in my head. We passed by the garage, and Brett set the bag of cookies on the hood of my car before approaching the back of the mansion. Three steps led up to a large covered porch that stretched the entire width of the house. Still holding the kitten, I glanced down at my muddy clothes. I'd better stay here. I waited at the base of the steps while Brett scraped some mud from his boots and climbed up to the porch. He knocked on the back door, and several seconds later a petite woman with straight brown hair opened it. I guessed that she was in her late 20s. Although I'd never met her, I'd seen her from a distance before and knew she was one of the owners of the house, Hope Barron. "Hi, Brett," she said with a smile. "How's the garden coming along?"
"Really well,"
he replied,
"but we came across a problem in the woods."
He gestured my way.
"Have you met my girlfriend, Marley?"
"No," Hope smiled and waved at me. I waved back, holding the kitten against me with one arm. Hope shifted her gaze back to Brett. "What kind of problem in the woods?"
"Marley and I went into the forest to catch the kitten and found a human skull."
Hope's eyes widened. "Are you sure it's human?"
"Unfortunately."
She shook her head, her eyes still wide. What does this mean?"
"Someone from the sheriff's department will be here soon to take a look at the skull. We'll see how things go from there. Does your property extend all the way to the river?"
Hope shook her head again, clearly still shocked. "It ends at the tree line." She opened her mouth to say something more, but then closed it, as if at a loss for words. The kitten squirmed in my arms, and I decided it was a good time to change the subject. "Is this your cat?" I asked. "No," Hope replied, "but it's probably the same one I've seen running around here a few times. The first time I saw an older cat, too. The kitten's mother, I assumed, but she was killed by a car 2 days ago." Sadness pressed against my chest. "That's terrible." "It is," Hope agreed. She pointed to food and water dishes on the porch. "I put out some food, hoping I'd be able to catch the little guy, but clearly you've had more luck."
"Did the mother have any other kittens that you know of?"
Brett asked. "No, I only ever saw the one. I figured someone probably decided they didn't want them anymore and dumped them here." A rush of anger joined my sadness. I don't know how anyone could do such a thing. I kissed the kitten's head. That would explain why this one seems used to people, though. I stroked his fur and looked up at Hope. "Do you want to keep him?" "I can't, unfortunately. Lonnie and I decided to keep the inn pet-free in case any guests have allergies. If I managed to catch it, I was going to take it to the animal shelter. Do you want to take him home?" "We could," I said with a glance at Brett. "I'm not sure what my cat will think."
"We can give it a try,"
Brett said. I smiled and stroked the kitten's fur. "Did you hear that? You're coming home with us." The sound of an approaching vehicle wiped the smile from my face, reminding me of why Brett and I were up at the house. "I'll go put this little guy in my car for now," I said. "And I'd better go phone Lonnie." Hope disappeared into the house. Brett came down from the porch and headed around the side of the mansion. As I reached my car, I saw a sheriff's department cruiser slow to a stop in front of the Victorian. Brett crossed the driveway to meet Deputy Mendoza as she climbed out of the vehicle. "Hopefully I won't have to leave you alone too long," I said to the kitten as I set him down on the front passenger seat of my car. My tote bag was also on the seat, and the kitten immediately batted at the straps. I opened the window a crack and shut the door. I stayed there a moment, watching him pounce on my bag, before I joined Brad and Deputy Mendoza at the front of the Victorian mansion. Brad had already explained the situation to Mendoza, and the deputy was now speaking into her radio. Several minutes later, another sheriff's department cruiser followed the long driveway up to the house and parked behind Mendoza's vehicle.
"I understand you found a skull in the woods,"
Ray Georgeson said once he'd climbed out of his cruiser and had said hello. His gaze settled on me. "It happened totally by chance," I said. I had a habit of getting involved in murder investigations and had found dead bodies in the past. It wasn't a habit Ray approved of, but he refrained from commenting on that for the moment, and Brett told him how we'd come upon the discovery.
And you said the skull is partially buried?
He asked. Yes, I said. It was probably the floodwaters that uncovered it. Ray took off his hat and ran a hand through his brown hair before replacing it on his head.
Mendoza and I will go take a look.
We gave him general directions and told him about the glove I'd used to mark the location of the skull. As the sheriff and deputy headed around the back of the mansion, Hope came out the front door. Brett and I chatted with her for a few minutes, and then we all wandered around through the back gardens. Ray and Mendoza had yet to emerge from the forest, so I decided to go check on the kitten. When I peeked in through the car window, I saw the little black cat curled up on the driver's seat, sleeping. Brett came up behind me and looked over my shoulder.
Sound asleep?
He asked. Looks like it. He's so cute. I leaned back, resting against Brett's chest. He wrapped his arms around me and we watched the kitten sleep. Out of the corner of my eye, I noticed movement at the edge of the woods. Ray and his deputy were on their way back toward the house. We met up with them as they approached, but they didn't have much to say other than that they'd be calling in more resources. Do you think there's a full skeleton buried there? I asked.
No way to tell yet,
Ray replied.
We won't start digging until we've got the right people out here to do it.
It quickly became clear that those people wouldn't arrive any time soon. After a few more words with Ray, I decided to head home. Brett was allowed to keep working in the garden, so I left him to transplant the remaining rose bushes. The kitten woke up as soon as I opened the car door, and I picked him up and moved him over to the passenger seat. He dug his claws into the upholstery and stretched before climbing on top of my tote, nearly tumbling off when he tried to peer inside the bag. You're a goofball, I said to him, giving him a scratch under his chin. He leaned into my touch, closing his eyes in bliss. I tucked the paper bag of leftover cookies inside my tote and buckled up. As I drove, the kitten went back to exploring my bag, managing to poke his head inside, but otherwise not getting up to too much mischief. He was adorable, and I was already falling for him. I hoped Bentley and Flapjack would take to him as quickly as I had. When I pulled into my driveway, I spotted my friend Lisa Morales' sedan parked in front of my blue and white Victorian. I parked next to her car and caught sight of her sitting in one of the white wicker chairs on the covered porch. She waved to me as I got out of my car. Sorry, I called out. I expected to be home earlier. Have you been waiting long? I couldn't bring myself to mention the skull, so I kept that to myself for the moment. Only a couple of minutes, she replied, coming down the porch steps toward me. Don't worry about it. I was enjoying this gorgeous spring weather. It's a nice change, isn't it? I reached back into the car and scooped the kitten into my arms as he pounced on the seat I'd just vacated. Ah, a kitten! Lisa almost melted right in front of me. Where did he come from? He's a stray. I found him up at the Wildwood Inn while I was visiting Brett. Lisa couldn't take her eyes off the black cat. Can I hold him? I passed the kitten over, and he immediately snuggled against Lisa, purring away. He's so adorable, Lisa gushed. Are you keeping him? Maybe. I'm pretty sure Bentley will accept him, but I don't know how Flapjack will feel about having another cat in the house. He's still getting used to Bentley living here full-time. I fetched my tote bag from my car and led the way up to the front door. I was going to cook, but that was when I thought I'd be home earlier. Should we order takeout? Lisa had arrived for a movie night, something we tried to do together once a month. Chloe was supposed to join us as well. Takeout would be great. I've been craving Chinese food all week. Then that's what we'll order. I unlocked the front door but paused with my hand on the doorknob. Maybe I should go in first so Bentley doesn't scare the kitten half to death. I knew that as soon as I opened the door, the dog would come charging into the foyer to greet me. Lisa kept the kitten cradled close to her chest. Good idea. We'll wait out here for a moment, won't we, little guy?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.